Hey everyone, it's Dr. Rick with a tutorial on altitude sickness or acute mountain sickness. Essentially what happens is when you're used to like Chicago flatlands and then you ascend even to someplace that's 8,000 feet, you will have, because of less oxygen, symptoms of nausea, headache, decreased appetite, sometimes even flatulence and body aches, muscle cramping. So if you are going to ascend or have a big trip planned, you should be training obviously, but there's a couple of things that you can take advantage of. Especially when you go to higher altitude. The higher you go, the more the chances are. I took a group here to Colorado a couple of years ago, and I felt the same thing. I probably should have taken the acetazolamide. This is also called Diamox.
So acetazolamide is a water pill, but in our discussion today, I'm going to tell you how I used it to prevent acute mountain sickness. So this is a standard of care for acute mountain sickness. It's well established that it does show some preventative uses. So it's you can look up on NIH or National Institute of Health as far as the studies that are out there. This was a cool one. This was acetazolamide versus steroid. So first, let's talk about acute mountain sickness. The reason I did this is because I was trying to avoid having the symptoms of shortness of breath, palpitations, chest pain, muscle cramps, and when I was ascending into a 14,000 foot hike of mine, I was training at what altitude that we're at in Chicago. I think we're at 1,700 feet. So that's, you know, it's okay. But when you climb that high, you're gonna have difficulty with scavenging oxygen because there's not as much oxygen at high altitude. Now, I was being passed up left and right on my second mountain that I did, that's Gray's Peak, by locals or marathon runners. Now, it could also be that everybody was passing me by because I'm just out of shape, but I don't think I'm out of shape. So even if I train like I'm kicking ass down at the Chicago level, it still isn't enough to prepare you for that level. So I did this, and I did this on my first mountain, and it did work because I attacked Mount Bjørnstad late in the day. I overpacked because it was kind of rainy and I didn't want to get stuck up there with my camera, my gear, my gun. So I had a ton of, I probably carried about 40 to 50 pounds. Half of that would have gone by the time I got to the top because a lot of it was water. So let's say 8 pounds to 10 pounds of water. Still, that's a lot to carry coming off a plane, waking up at 4 a.m. when I don't usually wake up to prepare for a flight, and then so everything was kind of screwed up that day, but I got to 13,000 plus feet. And I did take this the day before, 250 milligrams twice a day. Some studies have shown 125 milligrams twice a day. So it's totally up to you, but again, there's enough data that shows it's worth it to help with acute mountain sickness. This altitude sickness issue is usually because there's not enough oxygen and your body is used to having metabolism at a certain amount of oxygen. When it doesn't have that, you force the body to continue with its usual daytime activities or nighttime activities, and you actually push physicality, you're gonna get pushback from the body, and it usually can result in something bad like high altitude pulmonary edema or high altitude cerebral edema. I don't think that you'll find anybody at 14,000 feet having that, unless they're really out of shape, but the easy treatment is to just descend down at least 2,000 feet and then you're good. Or at least you keep on descending down until you have less symptoms. So if you ever have a partner, like I'm gonna have in the next Colorado trip of mine, May, June of 2020. So watch me on Facebook, Dr. Rick Hiking Excursions, and I'll start planning soon. But if you're really out of shape, I guess you can increase the chances for that, but I doubt that. Maybe as I start to approach training for Everest Base Camp, I might run into that, but by then I'll be hopefully weathered. So anyway, how does this work? This works by making you pee. It's carbonic anhydrase. So you use it, and when you use it as a water pill, it makes you pee bicarb out. And when you pee bicarb out, you pee, and you also become acidotic because you just let go of a lot of bicarb. When you let go of bicarb is It's a thing. It's a ion that's charged in your body to keep you at a neutral pH. And when you pee a lot of it off, your pH drops. You can't be too acidic. It's not a good thing. Acidosis is unhealthy, and it can lead to a lot of system dysfunction. So when you become acidotic by metabolism, by making the kidneys pee off, the reflex is for the body to fix itself by having the respirations or respiratory system take over and compensate. Really cool system. And vice versa, if you're blowing off too much oxygen and you're alkalotic, your kidneys become acidotic, you know, it balances itself out. It's the governor or safety valve. So when you pee off a lot of bicarb, you can become acidotic. That causes the lungs to breathe faster. When you breathe faster, you become respiratory alkalotic. So the respiration's getting you breathing fast and losing carbon dioxide and becoming alkalotic because you have too much oxygen is good for you, because if you're climbing a mountain with not enough oxygen, you breathe faster, you'll be actually able to maintain neutrality. But as far as this metabolic acidosis, it equalizes itself. So it's pretty cool. So not only do you equalize the metabolic acidosis by breathing faster with this, but you also are doing the treatment of choice. When you hit high altitude, some of us forget to breathe that often, and you'll just be gasping for air. But if you start breathing faster and with the use of this medicine, you're already compensating even before you get to high altitude, so you don't have that perception of shortness of breath, palpitations, you're not as gassed, the muscles are okay because the respirations are increased, and you get to avoid acute mountain sickness. So that's a good thing, right? Yes, at least for my first mountain. Second mountain, well, I was able to sleep in a hotel, but I didn't sleep because side effect makes you pee all night. So it's diuretic, it's a water pill. So even though I took this twice a day, day before, twice a day, day of, by the second night, I was peeing like every hour. And so it was working great, but I couldn't sleep. I was able to luckily take on the second mountain that was Gray's Peak. I made it to 14,004. I probably should have made it to 14,041 feet. So it's, it would have been a nicer number, but I just wanted to get to 14,000 feet. However, I didn't make the summit. Clouds were rolling in. There was a big goat in the way. And these goats are everywhere. But I did make it to the second peak. And honestly, I didn't train for this. I had I did my usual training as far as 15 minutes of hell, three times a week as usual on the weekday, and then like 45 minutes if I can find the time on the weekend. But that doesn't train you for altitude. I did a little bit of a hike 2 weeks before with a friend of mine, Abe, and we made it to like 8 to 10 miles, and that's about all I did. I think I attacked Mount Hoy, which is 800 feet. It's hard to train in Chicago altitude. So there is a contraption that you can rent. You breathe into it or you sleep in it. It increases, it pretends that you're in high altitude, so it makes the body acclimate better. I might invest in that. 10 days before, the studies have proven, I'll put a link down below if I can remember. 10 days before, it helps you acclimate, and it does help. I see the theory in it, whether you do the breathing thing an hour a day, 10 days before, or you sleep in the tent. That might be a better way to do it, but training is important. I would not do what I did. I think I have excellent reserve and good lactic acid tolerance. So for an average person, especially if you have medical problems, you gotta be careful. That's the one thing. The caveat is it does make you pee. The other caveat is you're taking medicines or you're diabetic. This is gonna upset everything. So you really have to be careful. So I think it did the job as far as what I wanted to get me up to two peaks, 13,000, 14,000 feet without much of a side effect. However, check out my video on ginkgo that I'm going to put, but I think there are other things you might be able to do, including training, hydration, and knowing your limitations. But for my 57th birthday, I wanted to do this thing. So Hopefully this gives you a little bit of an idea how to use acetazolamide.
And I was peeing all night last night. I couldn't get any sleep. So that's another important thing. If you're lacking sleep and you're going to try to tackle something like this strenuous, just try to work out or do a marathon without sleeping the night before, and you're going to really hit the wall fast. So you got to try to improve your sleep. Sleeping pills aren't good because they make you drowsy and dry. Sometimes I'll go with medical marijuana. This happens to be topical massage oil marijuana that has mostly THC, but I'm using it for muscle spasm because the hike I did yesterday was strenuous and I have a left calf cramp.
This is mostly helichrysum and wintergreen. This was awesome. I took it with me to an excursion. I took a group to Ptarmigan Tunnel in Glacier, and really good response. I did this and magnesium spray. I love the way this smells. So helichrysum is supposed to be an anti-inflammatory plant, and when you apply it, it hopefully will get into the skin, and I think the wintergreen does help it penetrate. The question would be whether it actually helps muscle or not. You know what? Because muscle, tendon, especially with me, I don't have much body fat, is so superficial, I think it did help. And I've used it in two marathons, and now I've used it towards climbing 14,000 feet. So I'm going to put this as positive. And there's no downside to this thing. It stings if your skin is somewhat dry, if you put it on after a shower. But I think it's, if anything, placebo effect. But I think it really, honestly, I think it's more than a placebo effect. The other downside of this is that it's a little expensive. And the final downside is that if you have somebody that's sensitive with their nose around you, like you do it on an airplane in a closed box, you will have the whole airplane smelling like wintergreen. And I've been told I smell like Bengay. And if you're, for those of you who don't know, Bengay is this ointment that you used to put on when I was in track and field in high school and college. The whole field house smelled like Bengay because that was the only thing we had. Now we have so many other options. But anyway, so you can't overdose. Every hour if you had to do it, it's expensive, but I would probably at least 3 times to 4 times a day, definitely after a hard workout. So that's my first positive. Because I was in Colorado, I didn't bring any of this stuff. This is medical cannabis. This is CBD, Mary's Medicinals Muscle Freeze, and this is Nature's Grace. This is this is half and half, THC, CBD. But both of these have cannabis in them. I did not bring this with me, but one is cold, one is hot. So I always tell my older patients, what do you like more on your sore spots, cold or hot? And I suggest topical as best as possible 3 times a day. Now, getting on top of the mountain, I would probably take this because it's not that big. But coming back down from a mountain, I would use one of these things. The only problem is if you're flying on a plane, you can't take this. You're not supposed to transport this across state lines. It is illegal. So actually can't even have it in your car in the passenger area within arm's reach because that's a felony. You have to put it in the trunk, or at least in the trunk space of your pickup or your SUV. So the problems with doing a big hike will be you'll have more muscle soreness than a normal hike, and you'll use muscles that you probably haven't used before, especially if you're from the flatlands of Chicago. So topical repair and rescue is important. I like the fact that there might be some CBD transferring into the skin. I think you can feel this because of its menthol. And menthol does have a distraction type effect, kind of like China gel. So if anything, there is a placebo response that says it's cooling, so it distracts you. Now, this, more importantly, this has capsaicin. Capsaicin comes from red pepper, and red pepper does distract because it's so hot. But this one is proven to show that it decreases substance P on skin-free nerve endings. When you decrease substance P, I think it's in type C nerve fibers, you'll essentially exhaust the nerves so it won't send pain signals to the brain anymore. So this is pretty good, but you have to deal with the heat. So this, if you put enough of it on, you'll get hot. So if you're doing this middle of the afternoon, summer, it might not be the best. If you're doing this in winter, cool. If you're doing this in summer, this feels good, especially for my hot flashes at night. Yes, I'm having hot flashes. Men get them too. 57, I'm allowed to have hot flashes. But this cools me down if I put it on my shoulders and then on my back of my neck. That way, when I'm getting asleep, if I have a hot flash, it's thwarted by the menthol evaporating of this cooling effect. So anyway, Those are the supplements that I use for taking care of the pain. Nothing like jumping into a hot tub. I did that with my first group I took to Colorado. We were somewhat gassed and wasted at the end of the, not wasted marijuana, just from all the exertion. And we all got into a hot tub. That was awesome. I didn't have any medical marijuana at that point. Well, actually I did. I had this thing. That's right. I did have this thing. One of the other hikers bought, and we used it, and I probably put too much of this on. So it does cause evaporative cooling. And I happened to put this all over my body. I was kind of shaking cold because it was so cold. So it can cause an effect, and it'll make the brain think about cooling instead of pain, which is a good thing. And again, if you put enough of this on, I'm sure you're going to toast with this. It won't really burn you, but you'll feel like you're burning. If you've ever wanted to feel that, check out Salonpas patches. That stuff will make you hot. So these are my rescues. This is what I would probably do to take care of on the mountain and after I get back from the mountain. But they're nice supplements. If you happen to have a medical card in the state of Illinois, you can get these two things. If you don't, then you can't. So one option would be Salonpas in cream, capsaicin cream. Another would be China gel. But there's a lot of benefit to medical cannabis. If you're in the Chicagoland area, just to plug the lecture I'm doing on September 21st, Saturday at 1 o'clock to 3 o'clock, we'll be talking about medical cannabis and its uses in modern medicine. So I'll put a link down below to let you, I'll invite you, but come on in, it's free. It's at the Schomburg Hyatt Regency. And it'll be a nice encounter with other people that are like-minded and probably a really good Q&A. I'll try to broadcast it on YouTube. So,
in addition to avoiding alcohol when you're in training, maybe when you celebrate after you're done, but and coffee, I'd probably tank up with fluids. I've got about 2 liters with me. I'm going to hike up, probably use it all. It is heavy, but it's worth the effort. There's also, when you're going to be doing a high hike, you're going to be breathing a lot. Taking breaths in frequently would be important, so dry lips are a nuisance, or at least irritating. So you might want to consider doing that. The other thing is, because it's hot up there, or it's cooler up there than it is down here, you might want to take puffies and shade, or you can check the temperature, the relative temperature, mountain temperature, mountain weather, see how cold it is up there. Even if you only stay there for a little while, to ascend that level is painful, so, and shades. So hopefully your training is getting you to the point where you can tolerate this or smaller levels, but I don't want you to tackle a good hike and deal with the issues. Last time we did a big hike in Glacier and then Colorado, I had a couple of people in the party have the same issues, and it makes it a little uncomfortable. And the problem would be, if you're in with a group and one person in the group has to go back, everybody should go back, and that's not fair. So hopefully this gives you a couple of bullet points, or at least pointers, about how you can tolerate, get better with it. Hopefully you never get to HAPE or HACE, that's high altitude pulmonary edema or high altitude cerebral edema. But if you just tackle this, do them about twice a year, once a year at least, train at your level of altitude, should prepare you for something like this. It's just cool. When you go into something like this, it is really calming. Nature therapy is awesome when you get to Colorado, when you get to wooded areas. If you haven't experienced it, even if you just stay at this level or take on an easy hike, I think it's worth it. So give it a try. Hopefully, if you have any questions or comments about how you tolerate it. Oh, there's also ginkgo biloba.
Ginkgo biloba is a great herb that comes from a plant out of China. You can probably get it anywhere at this point in time, but this is an extract. I love Herb Farm. I think they're a good company. Certified organic. So ginkgo, as you might have heard about before, has been touted. Very helpful for cognitive function, especially if you're going to be taking a test or going through board exams, or in this case, tackling acute mountain sickness. So the one problem, I didn't check this out, but I'm going to taste it now. These extracts are either made in glycerin or made in alcohol. I don't remember what this one was, but we're going to... Oh, that's alcohol. Oh. Anyway... So, and one dose of this is approximately 666 milligrams of extract. Ugh. So I'd much rather have the glycerin-based stuff. That's potent. Anyway, so there are some nice studies that are out there, most of them not in the U.S. So these are studies on cognitive function. So when I was in medical school, I remember trying to get this to improve my mental clarity. And just like getting a good night's sleep after studying for an exam, it helps to reset the synapses of the brain about what you just learned. And when you reset them, you reinforce them so that there's a track that's burned into the brain and memory is produced. So there is benefit, and this is just information on cognitive the benefits of ginkgo. But I've also had a couple of other things. One is cardioprotective, very small study. Cardioprotective effects, good. Good effects with regards to acting as a supplement to the usual acetylcholine medicines for true Alzheimer's disease. And it did show a positive effect, but again, for our, again, another one on Alzheimer's disease, pretty decent. However, I'm using it, and our talk today is more for acute mountain sickness prevention. So most of these reviews were small, one out of Chile, but all the small ones said there wasn't statistical significance on its use. But here's the thing with integrated medicine. You have to balance the statistical significance. You have to weigh the benefits versus the risks. Benefits of ginkgo, if it does help, and a couple of those small studies did say that it helped. There are some older studies that I've seen, you use it about a week before hitting the altitude, going from sea level to up to 4,000 feet, or 4,000 meters. And there, most of these studies mention at least 1 or 2 days, 3 times a day, at very low dose. But downside, there isn't any downside. Now, if you have a bleeding disorder, there are some issues with this and Coumadin, so you have to be careful. If you do have a bleeding disorder, whether you're on Coumadin or not, you might have to be careful with this. But the only downside was the face that I made when I took it. I gotta do it again, just to see how nasty this stuff is. Even before I swallow it, it's so alcoholic. Oh, yeah, anyway. Although, there's a woodsy taste, aftertaste. I wish there wasn't so much alcohol. Maybe I should shake it. Well, regardless, if it's alcohol, you might have to shake this stuff up a little bit. However, I think that using this at the time that you consider hitting altitude might be a nice endeavor. If you do it 3 times a day. I'd say 2 to 3 days beforehand, start loading up. The benefits, many of the studies didn't say what the mechanism of action was, so we'll never know, but there are cardioprotective effects as far as antioxidant use, decreasing free radical formation. There's also actually a cardioprotective effect in mice, animal studies, again, that were given a heart attack. So they wanted to test the effectiveness of ginkgo before and after the heart attack was induced in the mouse. Yeah, it's animal. Animal studies do help humans, but limited studies, so as long as they don't kill the mouse. So I think that might be worth it because the downside is essentially the face I just made. If you have an aversion to the taste, you can probably mix it in with water. In fact, that's what I probably should have done instead of taking it straight to mouth. Shake well before using. Probably should have read that first. Dropper into water or juice. And I probably should have read that first too. So you have to mix it in with something, dilute it. Okay, so number one, shake it up first, herb farm. Number two, dilute it. So I took a full brunt of it. I think that if I do that, maybe next time, perhaps in soda water, my favorite, Pellegrino, it might go down easier, maybe with a little bit of B12. So that's what I would do. I would say 3 times a day before, about 3 days before, which is essentially the day or 2 days before you head on the plane to get out to Colorado with me if you're coming. That would be a good idea. Versus the other option, which I'll talk about in a second. So this I'll give a thumbs up to because I probably didn't do it the right way. But as I gave you an example, there's proper ways to do things. But again, downside is very low. So I'd say it'd be worth it. If you do have issues with Alzheimer's disease or have a relative with Alzheimer's, check out the studies where it was used in addition to the acetylcholinesterase medications. If you have a history of heart disease, I don't think it'll hurt. If you have a big exam that you're cramming for, Again, if you're young and you don't have a bleeding disorder, I don't think it'll hurt. And the downsides are very low. So I'd give it a try. I give it a thumbs
it's
up.
It's an herb. You can't take that if you have a bleeding disorder or if you're on Coumadin. So be careful with that. So hopefully you like this. Don't forget to subscribe to me down below. And I'll see you at the next tutorial.